Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom.
How's everybody? Okay? You're blessed? Everybody blessed?
Yes.
Excellent.
Yes, yes, yes.
I have to tell you, I enjoyed the reading. I especially enjoyed the reading of Deuteronomy 28, the first 14 verses there. That talks about the blessing. And what I'd like everybody to really pay attention to is that the blessing comes by obedience.
Right.
And I think that Yahweh makes it perfectly clear, especially just in those 14 verses, that is the case. How many times did he tell us just in those 14 verses there that things are conditional? How many of us want blessings? All of us, right? None of us want a curse to befall us. We want the blessings of Elohim in everything. And that's exactly what he tells us in those 14 verses. He's going to bless us in everything that we put our hand to. He's going to bless our bodies. He's going to bless the produce of our fields, the produce of our cattle, on and on and on. But it's all based upon what?
Obedience.
How well we handle obedience. One of the things was the very, very last verse that we read out of chapter 29. It just leaped off the page at me. Because it says, therefore, meaning everything that's before that is based upon what he's about to say, right? And he says, therefore, keep the words of this covenant and do them, that you may prosper in all that you do. Now, a lot of times, you know, we wonder why maybe we're not being blessed in certain areas, and we need to do a self-examination and see if it's me. Why am I not receiving the blessings? Okay? And I would encourage you to think really strongly about that. Did you notice something else, though? That not one time in all those 14 verses did he tell us that the blessings are based upon whether or not we plant a seed into somebody's ministry, right?
No.
It was all blessed upon, or based upon what?
Obedience.
What we do with the commandments.
Right.
What we do with the Torah. He said it over and over and over. These things I will do if you do this. But the problem that we have is people don't do those. And he says, all of them. Now we do have people who say, well, I do this one and this one, but I'm not going to do those others. Recently I heard a message by a messianic leader. And he said something that is just really, really factual. Very true. He said, how many times have you heard somebody say these words? Well, I know that the Bible says that. I know that's what the Bible says. And then they add a little word of three letters.
But.
I know that's what it says, but. The moment they say but, they just negate everything they said. There is no but. He says to all of the commandments. He says it over and over and over. I like Deuteronomy, but I chose to teach from the Brahadansha today, from John, Yohanan, the 14th chapter, because it ties right into this. So if you would turn in your scriptures to the 14th chapter of Yohanan, and that's where I'm going to start today. This is, I entitled this very similar to another teaching that I did some time ago, which was called The Way, the Truth, and the Life. And today I want to talk about His way, His truth, and His life, meaning Yeshua HaMashiach, the Messiah. The Messiah's way, the Messiah's truth, and the Messiah's life. Because everything that happens to us as His children is based upon those things. I know that we all want to walk in His way. I know we all embrace His truth. And I know we all want to live His life, because His life is the abundant life. I'm discovering something else, and it's becoming even more true. I've known it for quite some time, but it has really hit me lately. That is, if you are a teacher of Torah, teacher of the Scriptures, and you teach truth, and you teach His way, and His truth, and His life, people are not going to like you. People who say they love you are going to walk out on you. We might as well get used to it. Scripture tells us that in the end times they will not want to hear truth. They want to hear what makes them feel good. They want a teacher or a leader who is entertaining, who will entertain them. And they want to bring in great big speakers from here and there and hold big conventions and have all the music and all of that kind of thing. But I would rather hear the truth. I want to know the truth, because when I stand before Him on the judgment day, all of that stuff isn't going to matter at all. What is going to matter is, what did you do with my commandments? What did you do with what I told you to do? How well did you handle those things? And so, I pray that you love me, and I pray that you'll stick with me, because what you're going to hear here is the truth. And you know, and I know, that you can go into the Torah and validate everything I'm telling you. All you have to do, I'm basing it on exactly His Word. And you can validate that. And so I make no apologies for what I teach. Let's begin with verse 1. Let not your heart be troubled. Now let me stop there for a moment. I know a lot of people who are really troubled. There's things going on in this world right now that are very troubling, very disturbing. And it's so easy to get caught up in those kinds of things and let fear take charge of you, rather than you taking charge of that. He says, let not your heart be troubled. Don't let these things bother you. Why? Because the one who resides in you is greater than all of those things.
Mm-hmm.
All of those things put together. We are the winner, right? Regardless of what it looks like on the surface. You know, right now it looks like Israel will eventually be wiped off the map. But we know, because of what the Torah teaches us, that Israel is going to prevail. And when everything is said and done, what's going to be left?
Israel.
Yahweh Elohim and His people Israel, residing in a land of promise that He gave to us. That's where we're going to wind up. Don't let your heart be troubled. But look at what else he says. Believe in Elohim, but he doesn't stop there. He says, believe also in me. Now, if some people were reading this, believe in Elohim, believe also in me, it's very easy to see that as two different persons. Believe in Elohim, or as they would say, believe in God, and believe in Jesus. That's the way they look at it. But may I tell you that this is inclusive. When he is speaking here, when the Messiah is speaking, to him, he says, believe in Elohim, believe also in me, is the same. There's not two different persons. He is both. He is Elohim, the judge, and he is also Yeshua, the Messiah. If I believe in him, and I believe in his power and his authority, if I believe in his finished work, then I have no reason to let my heart be troubled, regardless of what the surface looks like. Look at the word believe. You know, I've talked to you for many, many years now about this word believe, because a lot of people will say, well, this is what I believe. And yet someone else can look at the exact same thing and say, well, that's this is what I believe. And they're two completely different things. How can you have one thing and two people look at the same thing and have two different beliefs? Now, I hear people who try to justify that by saying, well, it's okay to have two different beliefs. Well, Yahweh teaches a standard. Should be the same for all of us. But if we don't go back and we don't break these words down into their original language, the way they were given at the time, then we may very well have two different belief systems about the same thing, but that ought not to be. Look at believe, the word believe, aman, to stand firm, not subject to change or revision, to support. Now, I've taught on this word many, many times, as all of you know. I'm sure you already have it in your notes probably a dozen times. But it's important that we understand it. You know why? Because I can pick up some Bibles today and look at the first few pages in the Bible, and it'll tell me about that particular translation, and it will say third revision. Okay? Ninth revision. What is that telling me? That means it's been revised all of those times. Why? If we have the word of Elohim, the pure word of Elohim, why do we need to keep revising it? It reminds me of back in the days when I was a pastor, and I observed people come to the front and, quote, rededicate their lives, some of them about every Sunday. Why do you need to rededicate your life? Why don't you just follow the pattern of life that He has given you, walk that out, and then there's no need to have to rededicate yourself. Just follow the pattern. Be a doer of the word and not just a hearer. So, we are to stand firm on the Torah. It says to stand firm. Stand firm on what? Do I stand firm on what I believe, or do I stand firm on what He said? I stand firm on what He said, what He has given to me. It does not matter whether I believe it or not. Just because I do not believe it doesn't mean it isn't true. Right?
True.
Then we're not to waver. We are to support the Torah. The Torah is His word. It's His voice. It's His truth. And we're to support that. Not back down, but defend it. You know, it tells us in the scriptures, contend for the gospel once delivered to the saints. What is the gospel? Well, a lot of the people out here would say, well, the gospel is Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. That's not the gospel. Yeshua preached the gospel, and He didn't have a New Testament. There was no Matthew, Mark, Luke, or John. Right? So what is the gospel? He said, when He was teaching His disciples, where does it tell us He drew the information? We had it last week. Beginning with Moses and the prophets, He taught them. That means He didn't have a New Testament. He supported the Torah, which is the word of the Father. The perfect and pure word. I was talking to my wife a couple of days ago, and I was talking about the fact that a lot of what I think and a lot of the ways I operate and the way I express myself has to do with legal terms. And she spoke to me, well, sometimes the legal terms are such that when I teach, people don't understand what I'm saying. And so today, I want to bring that down to an earth level and prayerfully get some people to understand, not necessarily you, but some of the people who perhaps are watching online, to understand what the words of Yeshua HaMashiach mean. And I want to break that down as easy as I can so that a fourth grader can understand it. So just bear with me. And there's a lot of things that we've been taught, and even as believers right now, we still have allowed that to infiltrate us, and so I want to address those things. And here's one of them. Yeshua is talking here, and he says to the people, "In my Father's house are many staying places." Well, that's the way this translation has worded it. However, in a lot of translations, it says, "In my Father's house are many mansions." Right? That's the one most people are familiar with, is the King James Version. "In my Father's house are many mansions." And then he goes on and says, "And if not, I would have told you, I go to prepare a place for you." This is a wedding term. He has betrothed us to himself, and now he's gone away to prepare a place for us. This was walked out in ancient Israel all of the time. They got betrothed, which means they're fully married, but they haven't consummated the marriage. That doesn't happen until the bridegroom has gone away and prepared a place for the bride. Once he's done that, he comes back to take her for himself. He takes her and they consummate the marriage. And so Yeshua is talking about a futuristic event when he will come and take his bride. But I want you to notice, in my Father's house are many staying places, mansions. And so I want to look at this. The Father's house here, the word house, is a word in Hebrew that all of us are very familiar with, bet. Means the structure or the family. So when you hear these words, we see them in English, but we think of them in Hebrew. We automatically know that a house can be either one. It can be the structure itself, or it can be the family that lives within the structure. Both of those are considered the bet. And so, here he's talking about in his Father's house, it's a structure. But it's going to be filled with what? A family. Beautiful. Staying places or mansions. Comes from the Hebrew word yashab. Yashab. Which means a place of dwelling, to settle or remain. Now in this case, when Yeshua says, "I'm gone, I'm going to prepare a place for you, and when I do, I'm going to come back and take you to myself, so that when I'm there, you're there." We're going to remain there, aren't we? We're not ever going to leave there, right? And so, here's one of those false teachings that I want to set the record straight. I have heard this from prominent teachers out here, prominent messianic teachers, that it says, "In my Father's house are many tallits." Mansions are tallits. I want to set the record straight that I have even said that in the past because I was following what someone else said. But when you look at the meaning of yashab, it does not mean a tallit. We don't live in a tallit. So we're living in a structure prepared by our Messiah for the bride. And that's what we're looking at, not a tallit. Why are so many hearts troubled today? I want you to think about that. Is it due to a lack of belief or trust? Is it because we get caught up in this, well, you can believe it this way, and I can believe it this way, and they can believe it a different way? Or is it because we don't trust Him enough? Okay? Trust means I trust Him to do what He said He would do in the Scriptures. Right? Could it be one of those reasons? I believe that it is, and possibly both of them. How many in the room know that when He says, "I'll do something," that He's going to do it? Do you trust Him to do it? $100 bill. This was to prompt me to share something with you. I want you to listen carefully to what I'm about to say. A messianic teacher decided that he was going to do a teaching that had to do with trust. And so he went to one of his elders and he said, I want you to see if you can take this $100 bill. And he gave him a $100 bill. He said, take this $100 bill that I gave you, and I want you somehow, some way, to slip it in Mrs. Johnson's Bible. But don't let her know it. Don't let her know that you put it there. So the guy says, okay. So he managed to put it in her Bible without her knowledge. She didn't know it was in her Bible. But she went to the services. And during his teaching, he said, I want to talk on the subject of trust. And he said, I want to just select somebody. So he said, Ms. Johnson said, would you come up here for a moment? So she came up on the platform. And he said, I want to ask you something. Do you trust Yeshua? She says, yes. He said, you're sure that you trust him 100%? She said, yes. You trust him with your very life? She said, yes. You trust him to do everything he said he would do? Yes. Then he looked at her and he says, well, here's another question. Do you trust me? And she said, yes. He said, you're sure? She said, yeah. He says, okay, I want you to open your Bible and hand me a $100 bill. And she looked at him and she says, I don't have a $100 bill in my Bible. He said, you just told me that you trust me. He said, do you trust me? She said, yes. He said, open your Bible and give me a $100 bill. So she opened her Bible and lo and behold, there was a $100 bill. So she took the $100 bill and gave it to him. And he said, now you just exhibited trust. He said, but I want to tell you something else. She said, I don't know how that $100 bill got there. And he said, I put it there. He said, I had somebody put it there. He said, so I knew when I called you up here that you had the $100 bill, that you could give it to me. He said, here's the object lesson. This is the purpose of the whole thing. Yahweh Yeshua will never ask you for something that he has not already given you. If he hasn't given it to you, he will not ask you for it. To me, that was amazing. Do you ever think about that? No matter what he asks of you, he's made sure you have it. And I'm going to tell you something else. That negates all the teaching that is out there that says, well, plant a $1,000 seed into this ministry. It doesn't matter whether you have it or not. Just go ahead and pledge it. He's not going to ask you for $1,000 if he hadn't already provided it for you. So you can't give what you don't have. I'd like you to keep that in mind. You cannot give anything you don't have. And the reason you have it is because he gave it to you. Me? Our home will be in the Father's house. Have you ever thought about that? We'll live in the Father's house, and I'm sure that it will be a mansion. As mansions go, Yahweh will be our landlord. Make sure you pay your rent. I'm just joking. Our dwelling place will be a prepared place. Remember, Yeshua says, I go to prepare a place for you. Now, I want you to think about this. Yeshua has gone away to prepare a place for you. This is a place that Yahweh Elohim himself has prepared for you. Can you imagine the splendor of the engineering and everything that you can expect when you move into this giant condominium? I don't remember the exact measurements. But it seems to me like, and I may be wrong about this, so don't quote me, but it seems to me like when he lays out the foundation of this place in the scriptures, it's like 5,000 square miles. I can't remember exactly, but that seems like the figure to me. Something like that. It'll be huge, and it's a cube. It's as wide as it is long, and as tall as it is. So it's a cube. So we're going to live in there. Only thing I pray is that he'll put me on the ground floor, because I'm afraid of heights.
Amen.
Amen. But I'm sure then it won't matter about heights. So let my heart not be troubled. Verse 3, he says, "And if I go and prepare a place for you, I shall come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, you might be too." Now I want you to think about that for a moment, because I hear a lot of people say, well, so-and-so died and the angels came and took him away. Some people even say, I saw the angels come and take him away. Well, I want you to read that verse of scripture and tell me what you think it says. Does it say, if I go and prepare a place, do y'all send angels to get you? He says, I'll come and receive you to myself. When I die, I don't expect my spirit to be taken away with angels. I expect him to do it. Okay? Yeshua wants you to be where he is, in the place he prepared just for you. Did you know he's prepared a place for you? There's a condominium apartment number has your number on it, and your name on it. And he's just waiting for you to come there and occupy it. And when you do, he's your landlord, and he's going to be right there with you. How great will that be? The greatest landlord there ever was. I mean. But we all want to be where he is. He says, and where I go, you know, and the way you know. Now, what's interesting here to me is, I want you to grasp this. Yeshua is speaking to his disciples here, and he makes a statement. He says, where I am going, you know. Okay? And the way you know. You know where it is, and you know how to get there. Right? But look at Thomas's reply, Thomas. He said, Thomas said to him, Master, we do not know where you're going. And how are we able to know the way? Why is that true? Why did Thomas make that kind of a statement when he was just told by Yeshua, you do know where I'm going and you do know the way to get there? Is Thomas calling him a liar by saying, I don't know where you're going and I don't know how to get there? Well, I believe that Yahweh has provided all of us as followers of the Torah and believers in the Torah and believers in himself and Yeshua. I believe that he has built into us a GPS. And it's called the Torah. And I believe we know how to get there. And I believe we know where it is. And so Thomas just needed to go back and review. And he would have known exactly what he's talking about. To know. You notice this is different than the word that I've shared with you before, yada. This word know is different. It is ra'ah. It means to be seen or to appear. So when he says, you know where I go, he's saying that you've seen the place. It has appeared to you. Right? And he says, and the way you know. You've seen it. It's appeared to you. We follow one way and one way only. What is that way? The Torah. That is our guide for life. That is our pattern for life. This is what guides us every day of our life. Okay? There's an old saying that I bet everybody in here has heard. You can't see the forest for the trees. Everybody's looking for the forest, but you can't see it because all the trees are in the way. This is Toma. He can't see the truth here because he's blinded by his own lack of belief and trust and understanding. And so what do? We go back and we seek and we ask and we knock, and the Ruach HaKodesh will reveal to us our shortcomings. Right? The obvious had stood before the disciples, yet they didn't see him as he is. Now here's where I want to get into a little meat here. I know Lee and I have discussed this several times. What are most believers, quote believers out here, what are they focusing on when it comes to Jesus? Flesh. They're looking at the flesh. If you can see him, it's because of what? He has flesh on him. But he's not flesh. Right? He's not just flesh. There's far more to him. If I see him as he is, it's because he has flesh on him. But the truth of the matter is, he is spirit. His Father is pure spirit. He is his Father, right? He is his Father with flesh wrapped around him. So when they see him, they see the flesh. And so everything that they believe is based upon what they see. Okay? And this is what Yeshua is saying to them. Don't focus on the flesh. Focus on the spiritual matters, because the flesh is the natural, so that you can understand the spiritual, right? Likewise, they missed the message he brought to them. If he's bringing a message to you that is spiritual in nature, but you're focusing only on the flesh, you're going to get the wrong idea of the message that he's trying to convey to you. Right? And that's what they do. And so what happens? They come up with terms like, well, Yahweh and Yeshua are two different things. Yeshua and Yahweh are not the same. Well, they base that upon what? Who knows the flesh? But then you ask him, well, if he's not Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh, what is he? And one of the stupidest I've ever heard is, well, he is a vehicle.
Yes.
He's a vehicle.
Yeah, I've heard that.
Now, what kind of a vehicle? Is he a Ford or a Chrysler or a Chevrolet? Or, you know? He is Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh with flesh wrapped around him. You know? This is not that difficult to understand. Modern religion makes this same mistake. His message was always this. Yeshua said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. That is essentially the message. Now, a lot of people would say, well, his real message was, repent, for the kingdom is at hand. How can you be a participant in the kingdom unless you have the truth, the way, and the life? So he set the stage with these three areas. Right? And if I want to be part of the kingdom, do I not have to know the way? Do I not have to know the truth? Do I not have to know his life? Because his life and my life should be the same now. My life is in him and his life is in me. That's what the Torah teaches. We'll see here in a moment, right? No one comes to the Father except through me. Why is that? Because he is the Father with flesh wrapped around him. And so if I believe in him, I believe in the Father. How many times have we talked about John 5:24? If you can't read that and understand, something is desperately wrong. Just read it. Yeshua there doesn't say, believe in me. He says, unless you believe in the one who sent me. Okay? He tells us if we do, we have eternal life and will not fall under judgment and condemnation. Why would he say that? Because they are the same. If you believe in one, you believe in the other. Right? Pretty simple stuff. But we love to make it really complicated, don't we? The way. Let's look at what he says. He said, I am the way. The way is direct. The pattern or the path or manner of life. So he said, I am the way. Not one of the ways. Not a way. I am the way. The one and the only way. I am the path that leads to righteousness. I am the path that leads to eternal life. I am the path that leads to abundant life. So if we want to possess those things, then what do we have to do? We have to trust him that he will do exactly what he said he would do. He's put $100 in your Bible. All he does is ask you for it back. Who does it belong to? It's him, right? But he trusts you with it. Here's Hebrews 9, verse 8 and following. Listen carefully, though. The set-apart spirit signifying this, that the way into the most set-apart place was not yet made manifest while the first tent was standing, or has a standing, which has a parable for the present time in which both gifts and slaughters are offered, which are unable to perfect the one serving as to his conscience. Only as to food and drinks and different washings and fleshly regulations imposed until a time of setting matters straight. Now stop and think. Israel, in ancient times, were doing all of these things, right? They had special things they did with food and drinks. You can have this, but you can't have that. And they were bringing sacrifices and animal offerings and so forth. So this is talking about them. But if this is so bad, who commanded them to do it? Yeah, no, right? So there's nothing wrong with them. He commanded this to be done. It isn't like they just made this up and decided this is what we're going to do. They were commanded to do these things. Go back and read, right? Verse 11, but Messiah, having become a high priest of the coming of good matters, through the greater and more perfect tent, not made with hands, that is, not of this creation. Now please grasp that. Not of this what?
Creation.
He was not created like all of these other things were, right? He says, you are from below, I'm from above. I'm not like you, right? He's different than me and you, okay? Says he entered into the most set apart place once for all, not with the blood of goats and calves, but with his own blood, having obtained everlasting redemption.
Amen.
So all of the things that ancient Israel did in their sacrifices and offerings and in their kashrut and all of those things that the modern church today thinks were so horrible, and it was just for those Jews out there, and they did these horrible sins by doing these. By the way, I'm just reading a book that tells you that a lot of the church fathers said those very things about the Jewish people, that doing these things, they committed atrocious sins. It's a sin to do what Yahweh Elohim commanded you to do? That kind of thinking is poisoned, isn't it? Okay? The way is pointed out in the Torah. It is our roadmap to righteousness. I can't be righteous without following the Torah. It's impossible. Because the Torah points me to the Messiah, who is righteousness. Right? What about the truth? Amen. Something that grabs hold or supports something else. The passing of strength or skill to the next generation. So Yahweh's definition then of truth is something that grabs hold of something else and supports it. What do you think that is? Let's say Yeshua was truth, right? He said, I am the way and the truth. So he said, just declare, I am truth. So Yeshua grabs hold or supports something else. What is it? The Torah, right? His father gave the Torah. He supports that, okay? And then it says, the passing of strength or skill to the next generation. Do you not think that's what Yeshua was doing when he taught? He's passing on the Torah, his strength and his skill in knowing how to handle the Torah, knowing how to handle the words of the Most High.
Can you hold for a second?
So this is for our understanding. But unfortunately, a lot of people fail to understand this. There's so much misunderstanding and things that just make me almost sick at my stomach when I'm studying them. You know, like hearing people make statements for which they have no basis whatsoever. Now, could you honestly pick up your scriptures and show me any place that it ever says that the Jews killed Jesus? Let me ask you something. What did kill Yeshua? Sin.
Yeah.
He died for the sin of the whole world. Right? Now, nobody, quote, killed him. He said, I give of myself. Right? Nobody had the power and authority to take his life. He surrendered it. Right? But we cling to all of these lies that have been taught for generation after generation. And I want you to become familiar with a word I had never heard before. And it's called cessationism. It's a horrific word that goes back to a belief system that teaches that the Jews are forever damned by Elohim, because they did such horrible and atrocious sins, and that they deserve everything that's happened to them, and they should deserve it for the rest of eternity.
Well, that was a shock.
A curse without a cause.
That is a horrible teaching, folks. But it's out there. It's called supersessionism. John 1:14, and the Word became flesh. Now, I don't know why. I'm sure that it isn't that I'm so much brighter than other people, okay? And I'm not trying to say that at all. But I can't understand why people read the same words I read and don't see what I see. The Word became flesh. If He became flesh, what was He before He became flesh? If I read that and the Word existed. Didn't He? Where was He? Tells us in John 1:1. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with Elohim, and the Word was Elohim. Right? And so, and when I read this, it says, and the Word. I know the Word was already there. What happened to the Word? He took upon Himself a body of flesh. And the Word became flesh. He's still the Word.
Yeah.
Okay? Are you getting this? He's still the Word, but now He has flesh around Him. And He pitched His tent. What tent? His body. Right? Like, this is our tent. And we saw His esteem. Esteem as of what? The only brought forth of the Father. Complete in favor and truth. How could He be complete in favor and truth if He was a created thing? He's always been with Elohim, and He has always been Elohim. Right? That's what it declares to us. Let's look at the life. We covered the way and the truth. Hey. A vital functioning being. Do you know if you don't have Torah life, that you're a walking dead person? You have no life. you're a zombie walking around with no life. A vital functioning being. How many people do you know that are dysfunctional? I mean, they go about the rigors of society, but they have really no real function in life. They're just here. I don't want that kind of life. I pray that you don't want that kind of life. I pray that you want the kind of life that is the abundant life that He gives you, right? That He bestows upon you, so that you become vital and you become functioning. You have something to live for. You have a goal and a function in life. John 11:25 and following. Yeshua said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. What is he saying? Mm-hmm. I am the resurrection. I have risen from the dead. And I am the life. I am the functioning person. Right? I have a reason. He who believes in me, though he dies, he shall live. And everyone that is living and believing in me shall never die at all. Do you believe this? You know, I think a fear of death is quite a natural thing with everybody. You know, I know that we all know we're going to die one of these days if he doesn't come back first. And we're still going to die even if he does come back. I know there's a lot of people don't believe that, but we'll be changed in the twinkling of an eye. We won't be as we are right now. Suddenly we'll be changed. But many of us will die and be buried, right? But he says here, and everyone who's living, believing in me, shall never die at all. How can he say that? Because when the last breath of life leaves you in this life, the breath of Yah is in you and you have a new life. And you won't even know that you just died. You'll just know something's changed. I mean, how great will that be? Go back to Yohanan 14, verse 7. Now notice he starts off here, if. Notice that, if. If you had known me, you would have known my Father too. From now on, you know him and have seen. Come on, how much plainer could he make this, folks? He's saying, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. Why? Because he is the Father with flesh wrapped around him. Right? Mm-hmm. It can't mean anything else. If you had known me, you would have known my Father too.
Amen.
How does he get to know the Father? How do you and I get to know the Father? Stop and think for a moment. We did it. The Father is pure spirit. We can't sense him with any of the five senses, so he couldn't come in the spirit. He had to come with flesh wrapped around him so that we can see him, touch him, smell him, all of those kind of things, right? So he's saying here, if you had known me, you would have known my Father also. So he's telling you very clearly there who he is. I am the Father with flesh wrapped around me. It says, from now on you know him and have seen him. That was the whole purpose of him coming with flesh, so that we could know him and see him. Otherwise, we couldn't see him. What did Thomas miss? He had seen Yeshua, but he did not see him as the Father. What did he see?
The flesh.
The flesh.
The flesh.
And that's all that he based everything on, is I see the flesh. But I don't see the purpose, the spiritual side of it. I believe everybody in this room has seen the spiritual side of Yeshua. And if you hadn't, you're missing the whole thing. Flesh is one thing. But remember, he said, that which is born of flesh is flesh. That which is born of the Spirit is spirit, which is more important for us to see.
Mm-hmm.
We see the spiritual realm through the natural realm. That's the way we learn, right? The modern religious system still fails to see him as the Father. Go to any congregation out here and you'll hear that Yeshua is the second person of the Trinity. You have the three persons that make up the Trinity, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. They break them down into three. Well, there's only one. Verse 8, Philip said to him, Master, show us the Father and it's enough for us. What did he just tell them? I mean, yeah. I mean, how dumb could these disciples be? Even I'm smart enough to understand what he said. Right? Philip's request remains on the lips of many people today. Show us the Father. If you'll show us the Father, that's enough for us. If I can see the Father, I'll believe. But the only way you're going to see the Father right now is through the Son. I'm not going to see it any other way. Yeshua said to him, Have I been with you so long and you have not known me, Philip? He who has seen me has seen the Father. And how do you say, show us the Father? Boy, that's beautiful. What's the matter with you, Philip? I'm standing right in front of you. I just explained to you a number of times who I am. And you still say, show us the Father. What do I have to do to show you an invisible spirit? How can I show you a pure spirit unless I wrap flesh around it? Yeshua is the Father manifested in flesh. Philip and the others were so caught up in the flesh that they failed to see the spirit that resided within. Do you not believe that I am in the Father and the Father is in me? The words that I speak to you, I do not speak from myself, but the Father who stays in me does his works. So when Yeshua did miracles, when Yeshua gave parables, when he spoke from the Torah, who was actually doing the speaking? What does he say? The Father who stays in me does his works. What do you say? The words that I speak to you, I do not speak from myself. You know, I don't think for a minute that this requires rocket science. I think it's very, very simple. According to Yeshua, where is the Father?
In Him.
Amen. In Him. Who really speaks to the disciples?
No.
The Father. Right? Who does the works? The Father. He just told us that in that verse, didn't he?
Yeah.
All of those things are truth. Verse 11. Believe me that I am in the Father and the Father in me. Otherwise, believe me because of the works themselves. Truly, truly, I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he shall do also, and greater works than these he shall do, because I go to my Father. Now, I've heard many teachings on this through my years of ministry. And the teachings I've heard is this. When he's speaking here, and he says, truly, truly, I say to you, he who believes in me, which means you, okay, the works that I do, you're going to do also. And you're going to do even greater works. Now, let me ask you something. How do you think that you can do greater works than the Messiah? Do you ever think about that? This is a misconception of this verse of Scripture. This is not talking about the ordinary believer. Right? So what is it talking about? Well, when we get down to about verse 14, 16, you'll discover. So keep this passage in mind for right now. Okay? Who is he talking about? Who is Yeshua speaking of in verse 12? Is he speaking of his disciples? Are they going to do greater things than Yeshua did? Of course not. Unless you think you can elevate yourself to the throne and you can do greater things than he did. I don't think that's ever going to happen. Stay with me a few minutes. Verse 13, whatever you ask in my name, that shall I do, in order that the Father might be esteemed in the Son. The religious system has always taught this, that if you are a believer, and they take part of this verse, this part, whatever you ask in my name, that I shall do. And they stop. And they don't consider the rest of the verse. Right? And so they believe that whatever they ask him of, he has to do it because he said so here. And he can't go against his own word. Right? So what in the world does this mean? Well, let's take a look. Please take note. Whatever we ask must be intended to esteem the Father. It is not about what we want. It is about the Father. And let's go back and read the whole verse. Whatever you ask in my name, that I shall do, in order that the Father might be esteemed in the Son. He's not going to just pour out everything you want and everything you ask for. If you ask for it and it will esteem the Father, then he will give it to you. Like I might ask him, you know, I've been a good boy. You know, I read my Torah and I did all these things. I want a gold-plated Cadillac in my driveway in the morning.
Right. Okay.
Well, do you think that's going to happen? No, because that doesn't esteem the Father in any way at all, does it?
No.
Do you know that everything that Yeshua did esteemed the Father?
Yes.
And he made that plain throughout all of his teachings, didn't he? Remember this, it is never about what you and I want. It's about what pleases Abba. If you ask whatever in my name, I shall do it. But look at verse 15. If you love me, you shall guard my commands. Also note, it's about loving him, but how do we love him? How do we prove to him that we love him?
Keep his commandments.
Shall we go back? Let me look. If you love me, you shall guard my commands. So how do I prove to him that I love him? Because I'm obedient. And I do what he's asked me to do. Now let me stop there because I know some people are going to say, well, you know, he just taught that if you just love one another and love God. In Yeshua's New Testament days, there was no New Testament. There was no commandments from Yeshua other than those he repeated from his Father, which is in the Torah. Right? He says, and I shall ask the Father. Here it is. I wanted you to grasp it. Remember I told you hang on to that last verse. I shall ask the Father, and he shall give you another helper to stay with you forever. The Spirit of the truth, whom the world is unable to receive because it does not see him or know him, but you know him, for he stays with you and shall be in you. So who is it that's going to teach greater things than the Messiah?
The
Ruach. The Ruach, not the disciples of Yeshua. He's speaking here of the helper who he was going to send. The helper, it's Azar, to surround, protect, or aid. Now how many of you, well it's only me and Lee, we were blessed with a wife for what purpose? To surround us, to protect us, and to aid us. Same thing he uses here of the Ruach HaKodesh. This is why it's so important that men learn how to treat their wives, how to honor them, how to lift them up and edify them, because they are like the Ruach to them. They are our support. They are to surround us and to help us, to aid us. To know the Ruach, one must have a personal, intimate relationship with him. We can't know the Ruach without a personal, intimate relationship with him. That's where the word Yadah in Hebrew comes in. The word him is interesting. Not H-Y-M-N, but H-I-M. Here's the beauty of this I wanted you to see. It's I've quoted from a Greek meaning. The word him, because of the verse that we just read. The hymn is taken from the Greek, and the word there is air, but it's spelled A-E-R in Greek. And it means to breathe gently. Yeshua was telling the disciples that the breath of Yah, the Torah, would be in them. Do you remember a verse of scripture that says we're going to be called up to meet Jesus in the air? That Greek word is A-E-R. It's not air like this here. It's this air. It's talking about the breath of Yah. I shall not leave you orphans. I am coming to you. The Ruach has come. The Ruach lives in those who truly believe. Do you have the Ruach? Verse 19. Yet a little while, and the world no longer sees me, but you shall see me, because I live and you shall live. Live. Here it is, Kaya. To have life within. To be alive and to continue to be alive. When he says you shall live, this is what he's talking about. Why is it you can't die? Why is it that you'll live forever? Why is it you'll live eternally if you believe in him? Because it's his breath that is in you. It's not your breath that's keeping you alive. It's his breath. Now I ask you a question. Can the enemy destroy his breath?
No.
Nobody can take yours, can he? And destroy you. The Torah is life. It is our life. Because he lives, we live also. He is the living Torah. Verse 20. In that day you shall know that I am in my Father, and you in me, and I in you. In what day? That's my question. What day? In that day you shall know.
Judgment.
What day?
Day.
The day that the Ruach comes to reside in you. The Ruach always reveals the Messiah. In fact, that's the primary purpose of the Ruach HaKodesh, is to always reveal the Messiah to the people. Verse 21 says, he who possesses my commands and guards them, it is he who loves me. Stop. If I don't possess his commands and I don't guard them, do I love him? No. Again, he who possesses my commands and guards them, it is he who loves me. I don't think you can make it any clearer if we just stop and study these things out and look at what it says. Okay? He says, and he who loves me shall be loved by my Father. So if I'm not keeping the commandments, do I love the Father? He just told me I don't. You know, I'm not showing any love toward him. And then look, and I shall love him and manifest myself to him. But you see, what is that based on? What is him manifesting himself to all of us? What is that based on? Keeping commandments. Right? From the mouth of our Messiah comes truth. Is there anybody that disagrees with that? Who does he say loves him?
Those who guard his commandments.
Who does he say is loved by the Father and himself? Those who keep the commandments. Who does he say he will appear to? Those who keep the commandments. Verse 22 and following, Yehuda, not the one from Kiroth, said to him, Master, what has come about that you are about to manifest yourself to us and not to the world? Yeshua answered him, if anyone loves me, he shall guard my word. There it is again. And my Father shall love him, and we shall come to him and make our stay with him. He who does not love me does not guard my words. And the word which you hear is not mine, but of the Father who sent me. These words I have spoken to you while still with you. In other words, he's saying, I've told you as plain as I know how. If you don't keep the commandments, you are showing the evidence that you do not love me and you do not love the Father. The love is not in you. Now, you know what's interesting here? I didn't write these words. I'm just reading them to you. You can read them for yourself. Right? So what are we going to do about it? I mean, really, how many times and how many ways does he have to say it before some people get it? Keep the commandments. But the Helper, the set-apart Spirit, whom the Father shall send in my name, what does the name mean here? I've taught you several times.
Power and authority.
Father shall send in my power and my authority. He shall teach you all and remind you of all that I have said to you. Right? That's the purpose of the Ruach HaKodesh. Now, I want to address something here. There are things that just are a thorn in the flesh to me. This is one of them. Hearing these people out here say, the Holy Spirit spoke to me this morning and told me this, that, or the other. Well, I'll be the first to tell you that the Ruach HaKodesh can speak to you. But I would be the first to also tell you this. He's never going to tell you anything that is not in the Torah.
Amen.
And that is not in complete agreement with the words of the Most High in the Torah. So when I hear a lot of these things said that the Holy Spirit spoke to me and told me to tell you to do this, that, or the other, you better pay close attention and not be afraid to stand up and tell that person if it does not line up with the Torah, you need to tell them, no, you did not hear that from the Holy Spirit, you're lying. Because it's time that we started nailing it to the wall, letting them get by with this stupidity for far too long. The Holy Spirit told me this, that, or the other. Again, I believe the Holy Spirit can tell you things, but it better line up with the Torah. If it doesn't, you better reject it and let them know you reject it. Let me ask you this. By what medium does the Ruach teach? How does the Ruach remind you of Yeshua's words?
If y'all wrote it in our hearts and our minds.
Right there. Open the pages and read what he says to us. Right? Now, I'll give you a for instance. The Ruach HaKodesh came to me in my house. And I've shared it with you. And he said to me, all truth must be based upon the witness of two or more. Now, how do I know that was a Ruach? Because he spoke straight out of the Torah. He quoted from the Torah. So I didn't have to question it, right? I knew that it was the Ruach speaking to me. He says, peace I leave with you. This is interesting too, peace here. I want you to see this. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. I do not give you as the world gives. Do not let your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. He began with this, and here it is again. But peace. Here's police, peace. It is the word shalom, okay? But notice, something that is finished or something that is made whole, a state of being complete. That's what it means in context here. So Yeshua is saying, I'm going to leave you something that is finished, something that is made whole, and you're going to be in a state of being complete. What makes you and I complete? Does it have to do with how studious we are? Does it have to do with whether we have muds, fuds, and thuds? Those kind of things? Or is it based upon what he did? It's based upon what he did. So the peace I experience is what he's given me. What did Yeshua leave undone in his disciples? You know, think about that, because Philip questioned him. Thomas questioned him. So obviously there was something in them that was undone, left undone. It isn't that he left it undone. It's that just that they didn't grasp it.
They didn't have the Ruach yet.
That's right. It wasn't in them yet. That's why he says it will be in you. Okay? So, very good. What has he left undone in you?
Nada.
Is there anything that he's left undone in you? You heard that I said to you, I am going away and I am coming to you. If you did love me, you would have rejoiced that I said, I am going to the Father, for my Father is greater than I. Did they mope around as he was leaving, or did they rejoice? Clearly he says, from what he says there, it looks like they didn't rejoice very much. Because he said, if you did love me, you would have rejoiced. That would mean to me they didn't, right? What about us? The more the Father gives him, the more he gives us. Do you know that? That's why he says, the Father is greater than I am, I'm going to the Father. Why would he go to the Father? Because the Father is going to give him more. When the Father gives him more, he's going to give us more. And so we can expect that. How is he going to give that to us, though? Through the Ruach HaKodesh, who is dwelling within us, right? More blessings and more blessings. Verse 29, and now I've told you before it takes place, that when it does take place, you shall believe. See, he's saying, I know you don't believe right now, but you will. When it happens, you will believe. He says, I shall no longer talk much with you, for the ruler of this world is coming, and he possesses none at all in me. But in order for the world to know that I love the Father, and that as the Father commanded me, so I am doing, rise up, let us go from here. How does the world know that he loves the Father? Because he kept his commandments perfectly, right? And he says so. And he also says, not only did I hear it, did he give it to me, but I did it. Do you notice that? So I am doing. Why does Yeshua say he was leaving? Because his Father commanded him to leave. Right? Shalom Aleichem.
Shalom, shalom.
Now, why do we do what we do? Because the Father commanded it, so. I don't know how this gets out of order every week, but until next time, study to show yourselves approved.
I've seen that one before. She's cute.